Lay a little groundwork. I'm not going to preach on Matthew 14, though I could for months. And it's funny I say that, but you know, Cheryl, it's been 6-7 years ago since I even preached on Wade Walkers. You know, so, but I like it. I like it. I love the story. I want to talk to you this morning about your testimony. Your testimony is so important. You can't have a testimony until you've walked through some tests in your life. And it's actually the wave of testimony. Because this is what happens. As a wave would come in, it you get a little bit, when you first get saved, of your testimony. But you build your testimony throughout the years of serving God. In other words, there are times you think you got it all together, you ain't seen nothing yet. Amen. Life is tough. I was talking with Pastor Mike about it on my way here, my pastor. And we just talked, we use that word tough. Life is tough. It's not that it's miserable. It's not that you can't endure it. It's just tough. You must endure it. You've got to press on. And as you get up and move through life, you find out that your testimony starts getting built. Matthew 14, are you comfortable? We've had our grandkids with us, and I'll have Colton at camp tomorrow. He's been catching fish and doing stuff like that, and they're learning so many things being around us, and which is really cool. But babies and children are content to toddle. I noticed that. They just toddle around, and it's expected. But as we grow older, we seem more afraid of falling. And I understand, because it takes a while to heal up. We would rather avoid going down than to learn to walk. Peter was a water toddler, if I could use that phrase. His steps, like his faith, were uncertain. He was willing to risk failure for the adventure of trusting Christ more fully. And Jesus was not about to treat Peter's failure as grounds for dismissal. We know that Peter sank while walking on the water, but we also know that he walked twice. He walked out, sank, and then he walked back. The scripture says in Matthew 14, again, we're just laying some groundwork here for testimony. The word testimony is a public profession of an experience with Jesus. I don't think someone is truly saved until you got a testimony. You got to express what Jesus has done for you. Matter of fact, the scripture tells us, after everybody that I know of, something happened to Jesus, say, go tell. Go tell. Go tell. The woman at the well, go tell. The woman with issue of blood, go tell. The demoniac of the Gadarene, go tell. Whatever God's done something for you, it's important for you to go tell. Somebody say, go tell. You got to tell them, man, look, well, this is my experience with Christ. He changed my, I'm not just a church goer. I go to church because I've had an experience with Jesus. He changed my life. He turned me around. Matthew 14 tells us, verse 27, but Jesus immediately said to them, take courage, it is I, don't be afraid. Again, the context here, it's at night, 3 a.m. in the morning. The waves are breaking over the boat. It's a storm on the sea, and here comes Jesus walking on the water. They got afraid when they saw him, and they said, Lord, if it's you, Peter replied, tell me to come to you on the water. Jesus, one word, come. He said, then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, cried out, Lord, save me. Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand, called him, you have little faith. He said, why did you doubt? And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. Why did you doubt? Why did you doubt? In other words, he's saying to him, you could have stayed up on the water had you not allowed fear to enter into your life. Wave walkers they're rare. They're few and in between. Many times we're like the 11. We're content to stay in the boat. You know, it's safe in the boat. This is a good structure here. It's weathered most of the storms. But if you're ever going to step out in faith and do something crazy, you only get this life. Yeah, come on. You just get this life. Who knows better than your preacher to tell you, you only get this life. When it's over, it's over. So if you get an opportunity to hear the word come, get out of the boat and get to walking and do what he calls you to do. Father, thank you for your word. It so challenges us. It so changes us. At times it scares us, Lord, to realize just what a risk taker that you were when you were here on earth, and what a risk taker you were creating us and putting us here. And then to tell us, who often get so full of fear, to step out, to take a walk, and then to have a testimony to share later about, look what the Lord has done. Lord, let us get to that place. In Jesus' name, and everyone sit. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. It's amazing. For some, failure pushes us to new learning. I don't know how you learn without failing. When you fail, you learn how to do something different or learn how not to do something the same way again. Deeper persistence, more victorious commitment, and more courageous hearts. Gaining instead of losing due to feedback. You've learned something through what you have gone through. For others, failure produces defeat, a sense of discouragement, a loss of hope, a desire to hide, a secret resolve to never again get out of the boat. When I walk through this, my favorite, probably favorite character in the Word of God, especially Old Testament, is David. David was a man who had tremendous abilities in his life, but they were God-given. And yet he honed some of them in his life. If you open over to 1 Samuel chapter 18, that's back in the Old Testament now. 1 Samuel chapter 18, I'll give you a little hint. It's right before 2 Samuel. David was riding high on his wave, my friend. I mean, you can't get no higher than he was. He was oily from the head to the toe. You know about David. He was a young boy. He was out and taking care of the sheep. Samuel, the prophet, comes in to anoint a king. Saul, and this is before Saul was even elapsed, but God had already chosen another man. He went down to the house of Jesse. When he got there, there's seven sons. And I have this Walt Disney picture in my mind of these seven boys stair-stepped all the way down from the tallest down to the shortest. And they stood there. And I don't know how this worked, but they had a ram's horn full of oil. And they would take it and they'd pour it over the top of the one. And it would release itself over the king. And it did not release and did not release and did not all the way through seven. And Samuel just looked at Jesse and said, "Is there another? Do you have any more kids?" And he said, "Yeah, I got one more. He's out in the field. I forgot all about him." Some of us have felt that way, that God forgot all about us. Amen. He doesn't even know we exist. Other people don't know that we're even around. And so he yelled for David, and David comes into the house. When he gets into the house, he sees this entourage of his brothers, and he sees Samuel there, and he doesn't know. But here's the thing. Samuel is soon to be his pastor. Samuel's going to be the voice in his life of encouragement. Samuel's going to be his exhorter. Samuel's going to be the man that says, "God told me that you can do this thing." It's important to have somebody in your life that believes in you. So here's this moment when he pours the oil, and the oil just goes over the head of David and moves to his shoulders and moves down to his waist. It moves to his feet. And I've often used the term, it's a post-dated. You know what it's like to have a post-dated check. It's no good till you get enough money in the bank. You can write it for as big as you want, but if you don't have the money in the bank for it to clear, it's no good. David's life, he was become king, and he's 15, 16 years old, but he's not going to get to be the king later. His testimony will be built. The oil flows over him, and now he's soon to be king. But what does he do? He goes back out and deals with the menial stuff of life, which is what? Serving, taking care of the sheep, looking after his father's responsibilities, all of those things. So he went back after it. You never get too big to serve. Everything about life is serving, 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 taking care of one another. So here he goes back out. He's anointed by the prophet Samuel to be the king. As a teen, he defeats Israel's defying giant Goliath. He chose by King Saul as his armor bearer, a musician to sing and to soothe him. He's loved by the army. He's loved by the people. Whatever Saul sent him to do, the scripture says, David did it so successfully that Saul gave him a high rank in the army. This pleased all the people and Saul's officers as well. When the men were returning home after David had killed the Philistine, the women came out from all the towns of Israel to meet King Saul with singing and dancing, with joyful songs, and with tambourines and lutes. And they danced and they sang, "Saul has slain his thousands." But that second chorus gave a thought to break here. "And David his tens of thousands." Michael, man, she just thought, man, David is that good-looking young man. Saul gave her to him. To marry. So now he's prepared for marriage to his Saul's daughter, Michael. He's a wave walker, a God truster, a giant killer, a praise raiser. If he touched it, it turned to gold. He was on his way up. Nobody was better suited for prosperity and blessing and favor than King David. Everything he did was great until he had a little testimony at that time, but he's fixing to build this thing. Because the waves are coming. 1 Samuel 18:28 says, "When Saul realized that the Lord was with David and with his daughter Michal loved David, Saul became still more afraid of him and he remained his enemy the rest of his days." Samuel was for him, the prophet. Saul the king was against him.
Saul felt he was a threat, and he began to feel that way. There's always going to be a test before your testimony. There's got to be something that's going to test you to see if you're ready to pass it. Immediately after Saul comes against him, he lost his job. He'd been promoted from shepherd to court musician to warrior, the most successful office in the land. But now Saul was jealous and started throwing spears at him, and he began to run. There's nothing like the spirit of jealousy to get on somebody. They tried to eliminate you from what your task is in life, and he's tried to kill him with a spear. Now, I don't have to get any amens this morning because I'm preaching to myself, so I'm happy about it. 1 Samuel 19, verse 10 says, Saul tried to pin him to the wall with his spear. But David eluded him, and Saul drove the spear into the wall. That night, David made good his escape. You know, you may not have been thrown at with a spear, something physical, but this tongue works as a spear. And it comes out, and it's like daggers, and it hits at people, and it hurts people. And he began to put David down. David did, what do you do? What do you do when somebody's throwing spears at you? What do you do? With David's life, he escaped. He escaped for his life. And at that moment when he ran, he lost his income. He lost his security. He lost his wife. She was actually given to another man. He fled to Ramah to see his spiritual mentor, Samuel. What do? You go to your pastor, man. You go to the man that speaks into your life. On his way there, Saul's army cuts him off, and he has to go around the other way. During that long escape, Samuel dies. And I'm thinking of the emotional distress in David's life as one king who once you thought loved you is after you. And now you're running for your life, and then your mentor dies. And then what about your best friend Absalom? He was disconnected. He loses fellowship with him. His job, marriage had ended in failure. His pastor has passed away. His best friend was locked out of his life. Then it got worse. I said, then it got worse. Then the scripture says he goes down in 1 Samuel 21. David took these words to heart and was very much afraid of Achish, king of Gath. So he pretend. So what's he do? Sometimes the best thing to do is just go back and hang out with the sinners. Hello. I'm not giving you permission. I'm just telling you, sometimes it's safer with them than it is within the church. Oh, y'all don't want to hear this. So he goes down and hangs out with Achish. Achish, king of Gath. Where was Goliath from? Gath. He's hanging out with the Gathites. Amen. With the enemy of... these are his enemies. And yet he goes down, and when he gets there, he does... David is... not only is he good looking, but there's a time that he got real ugly with his mannerisms. The scripture says he pretended to be insane in their presence. And while he was in their hands, he acted like a madman, making marks on the doors of the gate and letting saliva run down his beard. Can you imagine that scene? He's drooling. Now, I don't know exactly what it means, making marks. There's different connotations here, whether he was hiking a leg or he was scratching it with his fingernails. Can you hear what I'm saying? Either way, they thought he had to do something extreme to look like a crazy. And they said, this guy has lost. This guy, can you believe it? You can hear the talk among all the sinners. There. You know, this is the guy that killed our champion Goliath. This is the guy who was married to Micah. This is the guy that everybody sing about killed his 10,000. This is the guy that Saul promoted. This is the guy. But now look at him. He backslid. He's messed up. He's marking stuff. He's drooling. He can't talk straight. He's lost his mind. Achish said to his servants, look at the man. He's insane. Why bring him to me? So am I so short of madmen that you have to bring this fella here to carry on like this in front of me? Must this man come into my house? I got enough crazies around here. Yeah, and so they let him stay there among them. At that moment, they just let him hang out there. Where else can I go? I can't run back to Saul. Samuel's dead. Jonathan's departed from me. I can't get nowhere. So now I got to hang out with the sinful folk here. And I'm thinking to myself, there's a lot of people out there you have misjudged. There's a lot of people you think are crazy and lost their mind. They're just trying to find a church that will accept them for who they are. They want to build their testimony. You know, amen. Amen. So he's out like this, and he's running around. And I'm again, my mind just runs and runs and runs. This is not, somebody said, that's hypocrisy. He ought to No, he's running. This is called self-preservation. This is called trying to save myself. Nobody else out there is for me. As a matter of fact, David will go into it and tell you, ain't nobody out there for me. Everybody's against me. I don't know what else to do here except to act like a madman. Then he goes in. The scripture says he fled from there and he went into a cave. And I love this cave experience. 1 Samuel 22:1. David left Gath and escaped. There's that word, escaped. That means barely getting away. That means running for your life. And he went to the cave of Adullam. When his brothers and his father's household got the text, heard about it, they went down to him there. All those who were in distress or in debt or discontented gathered around him, and he became their leader. About 400 men were with him. Now, let me tell you real quickly, back up something. Oftentimes when somebody is prominent, is in trouble, their whole family gets in trouble. In other words, when a king takes over and there's another king you think is going to show up in succession, you kill that king and his lineage. So father and the boys are having to run too because David's so famous. So they're gone. David thinks it's only him, but there's a whole group of disconnected people because of what's happened in his life. And when he goes down and he gets in the cave, once this man had wealth, he had power, he had fame, he had friends, he had security, and what he thought was a guaranteed future has now slipped into failure. Welcome to your testimony. Welcome. You finally got to the place. Now you're fixing to build your testimony. Yeah, what you're going to do in that cave is going to matter about everything. The cave is where you end up when your props, your supports, your charisma, your crutches get stripped away. Total dependence on God. The cave, perhaps foolish choices put you there, or it's a result of circumstances you could not control, or both. You might have been birthed into this situation. All I did was kill a giant. Hello. It was a good shot, man. I took him out. I did something good. And now look what just happened. My success has made me run for my life. I didn't intend for all this to happen. I'm just trying to do something right. If you look at David's life, you don't see a man who was trying to self-promote himself. He wasn't doing that. He was just doing what he felt like God called him to do. And in so doing, got himself in a whole lot of trouble. So there inside that cave. The cave is where God does some of his best work in molding and shaping human lives. I've often called it the secret of solitude. Your cave, my friend, may not be a literal cave. It could be a place in your home. Back in the woods, it could be on a vehicle, but it's somewhere where you and God get alone and all of your stuff is stripped away and you realize, you know what? Without God, I'm nothing. Unless I turn back to him, unless I get my place, nothing. Amen. David was popular, charismatic, gifted, favored, but now he's in the cave. He gets in the cave alone. And this is probably the part that bothered me just a little bit. By the time you get there, the family showed up. Could you leave me alone just a few more days? Could you give me a look? He gets through the cave, and God starts healing him up. But then his family, the cave is where you discover that God is enough. The cave is where the anointing really does matter. The conversion of the soul is the miracle of a moment. But the making of a saint is a task of a lifetime. What you go through in life, when God saved you, that was a miracle. But for you to become a saint, to go from believer, disciple, Christian, to move into sainthood, and yes, it's possible. You don't have to join another church to become a saint. Can I get an amen? It doesn't mean you got a halo around your head. I know a lot of saints with broken wings. Come on, give me an amen. So there's a pressing through. But when you move through this dimension, these series of waves in your life, now your testimony starts to get built. It ain't that you walked on the water once and sank. It's the fact you got back up and walked back to the boat with Jesus. Now you got an experience to tell people. I walked on the water with the Savior. I've been out there in the deep. I've taken down giants before, but nothing really mattered more to me than my experience in relationship with him in that cave. In that cave is where he changed me. In that cave is where he taught me that without him, I'm nothing. Come on. God don't give up on cave dwellers. He didn't get scared because you run off and got by yourself. Didn't bother him one bit. Failure creates a vacuum for victims. who become later your friends. There's something about when people realize how human you are, it kind of sucks them all in near you because they realize, you know, I too am human. I really get bothered by not just the church world, but the media and everything else when godly men and women fail, when there's problems in their life, and people act like somehow they're supposed to have been perfect their whole life. I've seen it on the media this week. I've seen what's going on, and it breaks my heart because it does hurt people. The bottom line is, though, I'm bothered by those who I know have stuff in their life, and yet they point and lift their finger at somebody else's life. The scripture says, take heed, lest you also fall. Beware how you point your finger. David left Gath and escaped to the cave of Adullam where his brothers. I've already went through that. Let's keep on walking here. When his brothers and his father's household heard about it, they went down to him, and all those who were distressed, debt, discontented, gathered around him and became the leader. And about 400 men were with him. I want to start a church. I tell you what, let's start a church. You know who I want in that church? Oh, I want the popular, the prestigious. We want the wealthy. We want everybody that ain't got problems. We're going to start a church. I love when young people come to me and say, Pastor, I feel like I'm called to start a church. And I said, well, I pray the same anointing that's on me gets on you. That the same people I attracted, you get double portion. Because I can tell you right now, every nut, flake, and fruit tried to find me. All the misfits in the world, here they are. They looking, and I don't mean that as a put down. I don't mean that in any slight at all. But I remember getting instructed on how to start a church and who you're going after and what you're going to do. And I thought, Lord Jesus, it ain't worked that way for me. When I started a church, I was over here at this Crosby Motel that's burnt down. I led worship. I led it off a Sanyo tape player. I couldn't afford a Sony. I had a Sanyo cassette player. I would play that thing, and I would sing along with it with 20 people. Started with 50. We got to 20 real quick. I had a woman come in. I laid hands on her, prayed over. She went down like a light. And I thought, man, look here. The power of God's all up in here. Broke her ankle. I've had snakes in the building, rats in the building, wolves in the building. I've had all kinds of stuff happen. I've had people try to split me, hurt me, stab me. I said, Lord, this ain't what I was called to do. It's supposed to be simple. I'm like David. He said, yeah, you are. You got to build your testimony. You got to build. So you was a successful youth pastor. That don't mean nothing. Let's see how you do when I throw the big guns at you. When I send people that are discontent, in debt. Lord, has everybody got to come in here in debt? Discouraged. No courage. Now get them to be way walkers, son. For 20-something years I've been doing this. It hadn't got any easier every year. It just keeps on going. But am I upset about it? Absolutely not. I am a cave dweller. I have learned to go to the cave. I've learned to get in there. And even if family finds you, that's a good thing. They need you. And you need them. My family found me in the cave. All my family got saved after I went in the cave. It's amazing what happens. And you look back in retrospect, you don't even realize you're going through it. But you're building your testimony. Things are happening in your life. I need a slide, brother. I'm about lost standing out here. There it is. Distressed. Dad and brothers first, you get your family back. Everybody say, get your family back. Here's the problem. Sometimes when you're a giant killer and you're all that and everybody thinks you're wonderful, your family feels disenchanted with you. You know why? Because they know you. They know you as that young brat on the mountain that went through this woman's yard in your car and took out all her trees. They know you're the one that stole from Miss Ruby's store. They know you've got drug issues and you're drinking and you're drugging and now you're running around telling everybody you love Jesus. They know all about your past and they ain't believing it. But you find yourself in the cave, here they come. They connect with you. Then the distress show up, under pressure, stressed out.
How many pills can one take to help stress? Just how much can you smoke and drink to help stress? It's like everybody I meet is stressed. When a six-year-old says, I'm stressed, they are listening to y'all. Because they ain't stressed. In debt to lend on interest to have a number of creditors. The reason they in the cave, they running from the debtors. They there. Discontented to be in bitterness of soul, to have been wronged and mistreated. Who has not been wronged and mistreated? At least felt that way. So here they come, and David turns these men into his mighty men that can sling a stone with left hand or right hand. At a hair's breadth, you can hold a hair up, and they can hit that hair with a stone. He began to train them and work with them. But I want to tell you, there's nothing like the camaraderie of people who felt like they have failed that are becoming successful again. These are the men that he brought with him into the kingdom. These are the people that were his, if you would, his entourage that stayed with him everywhere he went. David, when he got in the cave, he began to complain. Let me say something to you. If you are newly born again, I wouldn't try this psalm. But if you've been with God a while, then you got permission to use it. Because David just got down and dirty with it. He said, I cry aloud to the Lord. I lift up my voice to the Lord for mercy. I pour out my complaint. Complaint before him. Before him I tell my trouble. Now, first off, how many know that God already knows it? He knows it. But it's important for you to know that he knows. So you won't tell it. So he begins to pour out his complaint. God, all I did was kill a giant. Next thing I know, I'm running from Saul. He's trying to pin me with spears. He's lying about me. They gave my wife away to somebody else. I've lost all my money. I can't find my best friend because he's been disconnected from me. And now my pastor's dead. I'm in a cave by myself, and the best help you can send me is my family. Come on. When my spirit grows faint within me, it is you who know my way. In the path where I walk, men have hidden a snare for me. They're trying to take me out. I look to my right and see no one is concerned for me. I have no refuge. No one cares for my life. Whew. I cry to you, O Lord. I say, you are my refuge, my portion in the land of the living. Listen to my cry, for I am in desperate need. Rescue me from those who pursue me, for they are too strong for me. Just being honest. I can't do this without you. There ain't nobody caring for me. Nobody's there. Set me free from my prison, this cave I'm in. Set me free from this position, this place here, that I may praise your name. Then the righteous will gather about me because of the goodness that you've been good to me. This is testimony. When I start praising God through the trouble I've had, Adullam, the cave of Adullam, the word Adullam actually means testimony. It's where you got your testimony. You've gone through things in life and you've forgotten that what you've gone through is to help somebody else. Amen. It's from there. It's after the madness. And then he goes to Psalm 34. And here's one of our problems as when we study the Bible. We think Psalm 1 came first, Psalm 2 came second, Psalm 3 came. They're not in chronological order. The Psalms are not in order. They just thrown in there all of the Psalms, 150 Psalms are there. But so when you look at Psalm 32... Excuse me, 34, you realize that this psalm is what David said from the cave. In Psalm 142, he's complaining, he's upset, he's mad, he's sharing his heart. But by the time you get to this psalm in the cave, after this, he says, and before he said, I'm crying, I'm complaining, but now he goes into, I will extol, I will praise, I will boast, I will glorify, I exalt his name. Let's go to that psalm, Psalm 34. I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. My soul will boast in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Watch this. I'm going to give you four or five ways here. I don't know how many ways, but quite a few. How to get yourself out of trouble. First, you got to think your way out. Why did God give you a brain? Don't answer that and don't look at your neighbor. You got to think your way out of things. You got to think about it. The prodigal son in Luke 15 gets to the very bottom of his life. He's taken his dad's inheritance. He's wasted it on righteous living. When I think of the prodigal son, I think it's like a pastor and his son. You think this guy ought to have it together. No, they don't. And they wasted it. He gets away, and he gets to the bottom of a pig pen, and the scripture says that he began to think to himself. He's got to thinking, my daddy's servants are doing better than I am, and I'm his son. I'm going to rise up out of here. I'm going to go home, watch this, and humble myself before my father. I'm going to ask him to forgive me. That's when you get to a smart place in your life. Humility is always the position of strength. I will humble myself before him. The scripture uses the term when he came to his senses. He got his brain back. Think your way out. Second way, get out of trouble. Sing your way out. Somebody say sing.
Sing.
I know what you're thinking. Pastor, have you ever heard me sing? I could cause more trouble than get out of trouble. I don't care. Your voice is sweet to him. He gave you the DNA of your voice. Learn how to use your voice. Learn how to sing your way out. Paul and Silas in jail at midnight. And again, this is one of my things about worship. I love worship. I can be a ukulele or a one-string banjo. Or no music at all. And you're in the bottom of a prison at midnight in the darkness of the pit. Your blood dripping off your back. You've been beat. You've been incarcerated because you preached the gospel of Jesus Christ to the unsaved. They put you in the bottom of a jail. You're in there with another friend named Silas. And the only thing on your mind is, let's sing. What? If I know I'm going to be dead in the morning, I'm going out singing. I'm going out praising. I'm going out saying something. I ain't just sitting here. And they begin to sing in the bottom of that prison. I don't know what they sang. I know some of you thinking, amazing grace. Now, I don't know. But I guarantee you it wouldn't have sounded like that. It had to be something to move the hand of the Father. Hosanna, blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock of my salvation. Hosanna, blessed be the rock. Silas, get in. Woo! Blessed be the rock of my salvation. I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. And as they begin to praise him, the scripture says that that jail began to shake and it rattled. And I've got humorous about this. I preach whole messages on it. I called it the first jailhouse rock. You can give us whatever. But the whole thing cracked open. It was as if God reached down to kiss his boys when the jail got caught in a smack. It was an amazing moment that the jail broke open. But I never forget that there's a jailer there who's going to kill himself had they escaped and they stopped him and he converted to Christ. Every wave builds a testimony. Every wave. Sing your way out. Sometimes you just got to give God praise. Faith your way out. Faith is when I can't see it. You got to faith your way out of this thing. Amen. To stay with the things of God. Come on. There it is. The Hebrew boys, I loved them. Three, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. If you don't bow, you're going to burn. And the scripture says that everybody bowed toward Nebuchadnezzar's great big idol. And three boys stood there. My heart sings for some teenage boys and girls to stand when the rest of the world is bowing. And everybody's bound to social this and social that and all the new norms and the gender issues here and the sexual issues there, that somewhere a teenager stands up and says, I'm not here to be mean or judgmental or self-righteous. I'm just here to tell you I love Jesus and I just want to do what the book says do. I'm going to stand. I ain't going to bow to what the world is doing. I'm going to faith my way through this thing. Yeah, they stood and they said, we're going to throw you into the fire. And the boy said, what we know is this. Our God is able to deliver us, but if he doesn't, we ain't bowing. He's able, but I submit to him. If he's going to put me in the fire, that's fine. The Bible says they threw him into the fire. And when they looked inside this huge vat of fire, there were four men walking around in the fire. That's faith. When they yanked them out, they didn't even smell like smoke. No smoke didn't even get on them. I couldn't even leave Granny's house without smelling like smoke. Talk your way out. Some of y'all are real good with this one. Hello, officer.
Talk your way out of things. Psalm 142, David said, set me free from my prison that I may praise your name. I'm here to tell you, little country, that what you're going through is a wave of your testimony. You are building it every time you go through it. Tell somebody about what you've gone through and how God delivered you. Stand with me if you would. Think your way out. Sing your way out. Faith your way out. Talk your way out. Promise your way out. Promise. I'm talking your way out. The scripture says, and David was greatly distressed, for the people spoke of stoning him, because the soul of all the people were grieved, every man for his son and his daughters. But David encouraged himself in the Lord. If there's one thing I've seen about David's life, there are indications that there were times he was just alone. There might have been people around him, but he was alone. He was alone in his decision to take out Goliath. He was alone at this time when the people had taken away his new wife and family, and he turned and encouraged himself in the Lord. He was alone at first in the cave. If you can't learn how to get healed alone, listen to me real well here. You're going to be a better spouse to somebody if you can learn how to be alone first. I meet too many people that think, well, I got to find somebody so I don't have to be alone. No. That's the wrong reason to find somebody. You got to learn how to first be alone, to allow those moments of solitude to change your life. So therefore, when I find my spouse, it complements. It's not a negative. It builds me. Jesus also knew about walking on waves. No one descended like him. Who humbled himself like him? To go from heaven to here? Not just to here, but to a barn? In a manger, in a trough. Nobody descended like him. Peter might have sunk halfway. David may have ended up in a cave. But nobody descended like he did. Nobody went as far down. And he didn't stop there. He went on to the bowels of the earth. He sunk a little bit lower. But he wasn't done yet. You threw the dirt over him, but he wasn't finished. Amen. There was no towel he threw in. There was no bell he rung. He went down, if you would. When you look at the life of Christ, he lost his position, his status as a teacher. He lost his friends. He's betrayed. He died a criminal's death. He was put in a tomb. That was a big mistake. This is where God does some of his best work. The tomb looked like a cave where he resurrects dead things, dead dreams, dead hopes. 3 days later, he came out riding on a wave called grave. Whew. Just standing up on it, riding with the keys in his hands. There's something victorious about serving him. For our church to reach its full potential, we have to get to a place where we express ourselves to the world around us. We got to let people know what God's done in our life. We can't be afraid to share with Jesus. I ain't telling you to be crazy, stupid idiots. That was you when you got here. Amen. I want you to go out and use the wisdom of God in your life to share your testimony. There are people who want to hear it. What changed you? I'm going to tell you what changed me. It was a life-altering experience with Jesus Christ. Heads bowed, eyes closed for a brief moment. If you've not had that experience, this is your opportunity. Pastor, that's me you're talking to. I want that experience in my life. Slip your hand up now if that's you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else? 3, 4, 5, 6 hands. See, I want to tell you something, guys. When you get born again, God's going to come into your life and there's going to be a change. Some will be very quick. Some, you're going to wrestle with it, man. You're going to fight this thing inside of you. But as soon as you give in to the presence and the Spirit of God in your life, old things are going to pass away. Behold, everything's going to become new. But those hands that are lifted, hold them back up if you would, and everybody praying with them. Lord Jesus, forgive me my sins. I choose to walk on waves, to dwell in caves until you change my life. And then I'll do it further. And I will share that you saved me, rescued me, pulled me out. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, give God a praise in here. Hey! Life ain't easy. It's tough. It's tough. You're going to need Jesus to get you through this life. You're going to need more God than you ever experienced. I'm not talking about more church. Church is good. Church is fellowship. Church is family. You're going to need Jesus. Amen. And until we get back to that in our lives, you're not going to see our teenagers or our kids change. Until we adults get back to just needing Jesus, to being dependent on Him, realizing without Him we're nothing, why would our kids want to change? Amen. I want to be more like Him. Hallelujah. I wish I had more time with you. Amen. Sure do. Be seated for a brief moment. Our servant leader's coming up. Joseph, I have no idea on sponsors. Okay, if you say 6 or 8, I'm going to guess for 12. Because I know our people. So what I need is I need about 10 people to take $100, or somebody take $1,000. Somebody do more this morning. It's $100 a kid for them to go to camp. That covers the meals, electricity expenses, and salaries of our staff, and to help others out. So we're just breaking even. That's all we want to do. If we can do that, we've done well. So if you'd like to help, I'm not going to just pull on you right now, but if you'd like to help a little extra, just put sponsoring, an extra $100 in, $200, $300, $400, whatever you can do, help us out. Also, 9 o'clock in the morning, we'll start ropes course. If you'd like to come out, this is really like a family camp. Your kids are there. My kids are going to be there. My grandson's going to be there. It's going to be like a family camp. So we all come out and we help out. We help out in the kitchen, help out on the grounds, help out at the ropes course. So if you could spend an hour, a day, whatever you can. And then tonight at 7 o'clock at the North Campus, we'll meet in the chapel and have a meeting about what's going to happen. The decorations, everything's going forward. I've just heard great reports already about how well this kingdom building camp's going to be. If you need a tithe or offer an envelope, lift your hand. Our servant leaders will make their way to you. From 7 to 8 o'clock in the morning, bring those kids, drop them off. Sleeping bag, pillow, toothbrush. They can't use mine. A towel. One towel should get them through the whole 3 days. You don't have to pack a bunch of towels. You clean when you get out of the shower and you dry off, the towel should still be clean. Just a rumor. I don't want people to have to keep reusing. Get another towel every time. Same cup. Never mind. David, why don't you say something about what's going on Thursday? Mention what's going to happen with our teenagers.
So Thursday at 6:30, meet here at the church, the teenagers, okay? Amen. So it's going to be a crazy week. We will have church Tuesday night here. Wednesday night, we'll have closing ceremonies for our kids out at the North Campus for you to pick them up. So expecting a great week. As we give today, we're believing God for more money, less hours, benefits, sales and commission, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, finding money, bills paid off, settlements, inheritance, rebates and returns, debts demolished, royalties received, favor, success to the kingdom.
In the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise, all that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet, hear your voice, word of God speak. Pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Word of God, speak.
Amen. Lord, we thank you and we just pray out of this place today. And Lord, I just pray that the word of God that was spoken today would speak and that it would continue to speak. And Lord, that's one thing incredible about your word. It never stops speaking. Anytime we want to hear your voice, all we have to do is open up the pages. So Lord, I just thank you for every word that was spoke today. I pray that it would bring life and bring a harvest of information into our lives that would cause us to change and look like you. That Lord, we wouldn't leave this message in this building, but we would take it and we would build our testimonies. And I thank you for the tests that come to build each testimony. May we have the patience and the faith to endure them. I thank you for the incredible word that was spoke today. Bless the people this week. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Amen.